Alhamdulillah, this is the season of Hajj. And so many of our brothers and sisters, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are embarked on this very important journey. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make their Hajj a good one, a successful one. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring them back safely. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring us the barakah that they will bring back from a visit to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a visit to the place of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is possible to talk about the Hajj from many different angles and for a very long time. It is said in certain circles that the difference between ordinary people and those who are extraordinary is that extraordinary people build institutions that endure. Ordinary people do good things. They're good to their families, they're good to their neighborhoods and their communities, but not necessarily build institutions that endure. And it is said that our Prophet ﷺ built not one institution, but five institutions. This is what is said. The institution of kalima, or the word. The institution of salat, which is the prayer. The institution of fasting. The institution of zakat. And the institution of hajj. That's only an approximation. Because when you look at the hajj is not one institution. The Hajj is many institutions in one. And you can take it, explode it, as you do, for instance, when you look at a scientific object and you want to analyze it. You can explode it and look at each one of the items, each one of the things that we do in preparation for the Hajj, performing the Hajj and coming back. Each one of them is an institution. Inshallah, what this khutbah will try to do today is to look at Hajj from a historical perspective. There are many young people in here, and they need to understand how Hajj was perceived, was practiced, and how it benefited so many people before the advent of our Prophet Muhammad ﷺ and after our Prophet Muhammad ﷺ finalized the rites of Hajj. The Hajj relates to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People say, those who are not Muslim ask us, why is it that you point in the direction of Mecca? The answer quite simply is that is the place where the first human performed the sajda to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you go for Hajj, and many of you have gone for Hajj, it is related that Adam alayhi salam and Hawa alayhi salam, when they were sent down to earth, they were separated from each other. See, here I want to transmit to you a very important idea, the idea of separation. The idea of separation that animates all great literature, animates all great human endeavor, whether it be poetry, whether it be a work of architecture. Every great idea is animated by the idea of separation, in as much as we as human beings were separated from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is a continuous endeavor that we have from the moment we are born till we die to find Him back. We find Him through salat, we find Him through fasting, we find Him through giving sadaqah, we find Him through zakat, we find Him through hajj. Meaning it's a means, a process. The idea of separation. So Hajj, in a sense, is to find our beloved. Beloved not in the sense that we understand it in ordinary meanings, but in the sense that at one time all of us, from Adam alayhi salam till the last man who will grace this earth before the day of judgment, we stood in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took that oath from us, arsala rabbikum, alu bala. We all said bala, yes, indeed we were. Or indeed, it's an affliction that we took that covenant from him. We were separated. So it said Adam alayhi salam and Hawa alayhi salam were separated from each other, and they found each other, recognize each other, arafa. See, again, it's very possible when you start a discussion of the Hajj to take off in a certain direction. Arafa itself is several khutbas in one. One of the meanings, Ayn, is the recognition of the names of Allah, recognition that Adam alayhi salam and Hawa alayhi salam had of each other, and hence the common origin of all human beings. So it is said that they recognized each other and they prayed at the place of sajda. Sajda is the proper relationship between a human being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, what is the relationship? There is no relationship. The only relationship, you want to think it from a human perspective, is when a human being goes into sajda, surrenders completely, and beseeches Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his munificence and his mercy. So that was the first place of sajda. And eons went by, ages went by, and it's related that during the great flood, as it happens in many floods, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was destroyed. So many people who have not gone for Hajj, they ask me, how is it possible in the desert that you will have a flood? Well, if you want to see what kind of flood you can have in Mecca, go there during the winter months, during the rainy months. We had the good fortune at one time in 77 to be there during the month of December, and all the waters from the various different mountains converge towards the Kaaba, which is at the center of you in the valley. And the water, no exaggeration, could be as high as 20 feet. No exaggeration. We ourselves saw it. So the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was destroyed until the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam. It was reconstructed, and the story and the historical evidence for it is the Quran. Ibrahim alayhi salam with his son Ismail alayhi salam, they reconstructed the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it has stayed subject to the reconstructions over the years and the destructions and so on, as it was at the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So first of all, it's a visit to the place of the first sajda. As the Quran says, the first house for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was established in Mecca, meaning Mecca, full of blessings for humankind. So one goes there for remembering the first sajda, and the place of sajda establishes only a direction. Just imagine humanity if they had multiple directions, because another thought that I want to pass up to the young people in here, whereas so many religions are a projection of the earth upon the heavens, Islam is a projection of the heavens upon the earth. See, for instance, in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us, Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ, that, not this, this is a demonstrated pronoun, the book that is in Lughul Mahfuz out there, of which the Quran is a portion, the final portion, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the same sense, the Kaaba is a reflection. It is a reflection of the heavens upon the earth. It is said that there is the Baitul Ma'mur. The Baitul Ma'mur is the place in the heavens where all the angels circle around it. What a place that must be. Imagine billions, zillions of angels circulating around a central focus. And if you can withstand that imagination and withstand the projection of that upon the Kaaba, you will have some semblance of the spirituality that's associated with the Kaaba. This Khatib believes that indeed it is a projection of Baitul Ma'mur upon this earth. I believe that. It's a spiritual statement. It is not of this earth, it is not of the heavens, but it's a projection, just as Islam is a projection of the heavens upon the earth. And hence when people discuss about, for instance, Islam as a religion, Islam is not a religion, Islam is a deen. It is much more than a religion. Religion has different connotations. It's a limitation of the English language. So one goes there to commemorate and to associate with a projection of the heavens upon the earth. Now I said, we'll relate to it from a historical sense. Even after our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what I'll do very briefly is to touch upon some events so that the young people in here carry back with them not just the spirituality of the place, and I'm sure many khatibs will stand here, inshallah, and they will talk about the spirituality of Hajj, because it's a multi-dimensional, multi-institutional institution. It's not an institution, many institutions in one. Women in Hajj, for instance. In the 8th century, that is approximately 150 years after the time of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the Islamic domains extended all the way from the river Indus to the Pyrenees Mountains, which divide France from Spain, all the way from what is today Pakistan to what is today Spain and France. At that time, at the beginning of the 8th century, Harun al-Rashid was the Khalifa in Baghdad, and his wife Zubaydah performed the Hajj. What a marvelous lady she was. People say, well, you know, Islam keeps women down. What? They have not studied the history of Islam. They do not know how Islam took women from the position that they were in and elevated them to the highest of the high. This lady performed the Hajj. Since she was the wife of the Khalifa, she took a big entourage. And not only did she perform the Hajj, noticing that there was not a good road between Baghdad and Makkah, she constructed a road. Of course, the road, because of the sand that blows across Rabb al-Khali, it gets covered up, but the road is still visible if you look at it from satellites. Not only that, when she went for Hajj, she noticed that there was a dearth of water. You remember, the Kaaba was built in the desert, and people said, why was it built in the desert? You know, think of khilwa. If you want to be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you want to isolate yourself. You want to somehow absolve yourself of all the connections, the distractions that you have from the outside world. And what better place is there than the desert to isolate yourself so that you are in a one-to-one relationship, in a relationship center, sajda, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was built in a desert. And it's mentioned in the Quran when Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he leaves his wife and his baby, he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, subhanahu wa ta'ala, put mercy in the minds, in the hearts of some of the denizens, that those who live in this area, so that my children would partake of some fruit. So the desert is where the Kaaba was located. Zubaydah saw that there was no water, so she built a cistern, a system of conduits, bringing water from the mountains to the location of the Kaaba. And those cisterns are still there. Disrepair, but still there. What a marvelous lady she was. Not only was she the wife of the Khalifa, but she did this wonderful thing that was of benefit to people for generations to come. Let's move on, especially for the young people. In the 14th century, and I'll paint for you what the 14th century was like. The 14th century obviously came after the 13th century. The 13th century was a century of devastation, complete total devastation. On the one hand, there was devastation of the invasions from Europe, which is what we call the Crusades. On the other hand, the much more, with greater intensity, the devastations of the Mongols between 1219 and 1258, when all the areas from the Amudarya, which is in Central Asia, Uzbekistan, to Baghdad and up to Jerusalem, the Battle of Ain Jalut in 1262. All that area was completely, totally destroyed. Then came the 14th century. In the 14th century, there were only three Muslim kingdoms standing on the feet. One was the Mongol Sultanate of Delhi, who had to continuously fend off the Mongols. The second was the Mamluks of Egypt, who fought a brave and successful battle against the Mongols in 1262. On the outskirts of Jerusalem, and there was the Empire of Mali. The Empire of Mali, African kingdom, is something that most Muslims may not know about. Mali was by far the richest kingdom in the world in the 14th century. Why? They had access to the gold mines of Ghana. And the king, Mansa, he means Mansa, Mansa Musa, he was perhaps the richest man on earth in the 14th century. He decided to go for Hajj. And it is related. This is important. He is related. He took with him so much gold, and he spent with them. He traveled through the desert, and I don't want to go into all the trade routes that existed. He traveled through the desert, went to Egypt. Egypt was a very prosperous place on earth at the time because they controlled the trade between the Mediterranean and the East, the space tribe. And even so, Mansa Musa brought so much gold, it caused inflation in Egypt. When there is a supply of money, then obviously prices go up and you have inflation. He spent so much money that he influenced the economy of not just Egypt, but all of the dominions that were controlled by the Mongols, namely Syria, and into Libya, and along the coast of Hijaz. He went to Hajj, came back, and on the way back, what did he take with him? He brought back with him copies of the Quran. He brought back with him scholars. He brought back with him knowledge. My dear brothers and sisters, my young brothers and sisters, knowledge is the basis of Islam. There was a time when the kings would do anything to acquire knowledge. In the 16th century, just another passing example, there was a Mughal empire whose name was Humayun. He was defeated by another king, and he had to flee. And what did he take with him? He took with him 150,000 books. That's how people value knowledge. Knowledge is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a fire that cannot be extinguished. You cannot pass on from father to son like you pass on a piece of paper or property. Knowledge is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He took that knowledge and built Timbuktu into one of the premier cities of the world. Unfortunately, the river Niger that used to flow by the city of Timbuktu has shifted down because of the desert. But even now, it is a city to behold. Mansa Musa, everyone put the kingdom of Mali upon the global picture. Indeed, there are some people who say that Africans discovered America way before Columbus discovered America. And again, that's another story. If it happened, it happened at the time of Mansa Musa, because he had the engineering material, he had the ability, the know-how, and he had the means, which is capital, to make it happen. And there are historical records to prove that. Yet another example, again because of the time, I would like to finish in the next 3 to 5 minutes, if I may. In modern times, the Hajjaj Malcolm X, one of the great personalities, those who have been in America the last 50, 60, 70 years, and have lived through what went on in the 50s and the 60s, so one of the great personalities who influenced the flow of history in the United States. He went for Hajj in 1964. I don't want to go into the other aspects of it. Before he went for Hajj, he was of the opinion that people could be divided on the basis of race and color. When he went for Hajj, he was transformed. Hajj is transformation from within and transformation from without. At the time of Mansa Musa, you saw how the kingdom of Mali was transformed as a nation. Here is a case where a great leader, an individual, is transformed. When you go for Hajj, you come back transformed. And again, what you can talk about, each one of the events in the Hajj is a transformation. He came back completely transformed. Unfortunately, he did not live to build an edifice, a social edifice, based upon his new vision of Islam, his new vision of America. That is Hajj from a historical perspective. And I'd like to close as to why it is and how it is from a historical perspective that people go there, not just drink from the waters in the Zamzam, but drink from the waters that come down from the heavens and come back ebullient with the Nur Ilahi, the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then they go on to the place where our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is buried and come back with the Nur that radiates from the city of light. Why is it that it happens? It happens because of the Hajj itself. Because the Hajj is not just a place. The Hajj is a visit to a place which is a reflection of the heavens upon earth. It's a reflection of Baitul Mahmud. It's a reflection of what the Prophet taught us in the final Hajj, which was the first Hajj. And it behooves us to remember some of the things he taught us in this, in that last Hajj. If the young people wish to understand the personality of our Prophet Muhammad, nothing else, read the last khutbah. The last khutbah of our Prophet Muhammad that he gave at Jabal Rahman, at the Mount of Arafah. Two or three things that we must remember even in this day and age. Number one, he talked about men and women. After reminding everyone to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to observe his commandments, he reminded us of the rights and responsibilities of men and women. There are so many people today, they say, well, Islam keeps women down. Read the instructions, read the hidayah of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Read what is there in the Quran. The Quran is our guide. The Quran elevated humankind. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you men have rights over women, and they, women, have rights over you. Mutual rights and responsibilities. Rights and responsibilities. Adl. Adl means right and responsibilities. Many other meanings too. Women have the rights. Women have the responsibilities. Then the Prophet wanted to lay the foundation of a just society. Not 1500 years ago, he said clearly, an Arab is not better than a non-Arab. A black man is not better than a white man. If there is to be a difference, it is only on the basis of his good deeds. What a marvelous statement. 1500 years ago, he laid the foundation of a just society, a just world. And that's what the Hajj is about. When you put on the ihram and you say, labbaik, Allahumma labbaik, labbaik, la sharika laka labbaik, labbaik, innal hamda. When you do that, that's what you do. You have taken out your snake skin and you have said, Allah, before Allah, we are all one, does not matter who it is. So he taught us to be brothers and sisters, not just black and white. In America today, if you want to understand America, the biggest schism that we have is race. Heal that wound, America will be a much greater place, historically and today. And in the world today, people are divided on the basis of what? But this belongs to you, this belongs to me, I'm taller, I'm whatever, I'm white, black, no, nothing. The Prophet taught us that. And lastly, he laid the foundation of the just economic system. He said, and he reiterated the teachings of the Quran, no riba. You see, so many khatibs, so many imams avoid the issue of riba. The Quran is very clear. The Quran says, he who consumes riba is as if he has consumed fire, as if he is friends with the devil, making a covenant with the devil. Stay away from riba. I know the economic situation in the world may not permit us to do that, but at least know that it is not right. It's not correct. The Prophet in his last khutbah reminded us of the evils of riba, of the evils that humankind will buy for itself if it embarks on that path. And there are so many other hidayah that he gave us. So, in summary, whether you look at the Hajj from a historical perspective, from a spiritual perspective, the perspective that indeed the Kaaba is a reflection of the heavens and earth, a perspective that the Hajj is a journey within and a journey without, a journey to discover ourselves or to discover our origins through our father Adam alayhi salam and our mother Hawa alayhi salam, a process of discovery of how we relate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter how we look at it, it's many institutions in one. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring back those who have embarked on Hajj with safety. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them all the blessings of Hajj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the Hajj be successful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also heal those who are sick. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala healing not just in the physical sense, healing also within the heart. Because the healing of the heart is even more important than the healing of the body. So many of the diseases of the body are a reflection of the diseases. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heal them all. والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. The Hajj concludes with the Tawaf, but then it's also a blessing to visit the city of the Prophet, Madinatul Munawwarah. It is not a requirement of the Hajj to visit the city of the Prophet, but how can you come so close to Nur Ilahi without partaking of the source or the medium or the message that came through our Prophet Muhammad? So those who have the privilege, the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether you do an Umrah or a Hajj, make sure you visit the city of the Prophet. Because the mosque of the Prophet gives you vibrations that are qualitatively and quantitatively complementary, different, and yet sublime in their own way from the vibrations that you receive in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whereas the vibrations that you receive in the Kaaba overwhelm you, it is like you're confronting a tsunami. That's how deep and how powerful are the vibrations that you feel when you're in the Kaaba, one-to-one in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you pray at Maqam Ibrahim, or very close to the walls of the Kaaba itself, or you're a certain distance, just the sight of it. But when you are in the presence of the tomb of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the mosque of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the vibrations are like balmy. It's like the reflection from the moon rather than the hot rays of the sun. That's the approximate analogy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it all possible for all of us to visit the tomb of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and partake of the blessings that come from the visit. Let us pray Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Allahumma sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وافتح لنا فتحا قريبا اللهم اجعلنا من لدنك وليا اللهم اجعلنا من لدنك سلطانا نصيرا واكتب الصحة والسلامة والعفو والعافية والنصرة علينا وعلى الحجاج والزوار والغزاة والمقيمين والمسافرين في بركة وبحرك وجبرك من أمة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم أجمعين وسلاما على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي إلى